conductor and director of music at Imperial. Before I introduce you to our performers for this concert, I wanted to tell you a little about the Blyth Centre and its place in the college's cultural life. Since its inception in 2002, the Blyth Centre has become a much-loved and vital resource to both our students and staff. It provides a full programme of creative activities, alongside an art gallery, an art studio and a suite of 10 music practice rooms. The Blyth Centre has been presenting some of the UK's finest musicians in this weekly Lunchtime Concert series. As part of the series, we are enormously proud to showcase Imperial's homegrown musical talent with a triannual concert entitled Imperial Performers. Those who take part are often drawn from two unique initiatives. The first is the AESS Music Scholarship Scheme. This gives students arriving at Imperial for their first degree 3 years of free instrumental tuition at the Royal College of Music. And the second is the prestigious Physics Music Joint Honours degree, again in partnership with the RCM. They, like us, see the arts and sciences not as opposites, but as complementary pursuits. It is easy to forget, but there's nothing new here. As Albert Einstein once said, after a certain high level of technical skill is achieved, science and art tend to coalesce in aesthetics, plasticity and form. And the greatest scientists are always artists as well. For this concert, it is my great pleasure to introduce you to one of our very talented physics students on the Joint Honours course, pianist Avishka Edirisinghe. His programme is presented in preparation for his final recital examination at the RCM, and he is joined by his brother Danushka, currently an ABRSM scholar at the Royal Academy of Music. Thank you so much for listening, and Avishka, over to you.
Thank you, Oliver. I'm delighted to introduce to you all a concert performed by my brother and I, built around two of my favourite composers, Leos Janacek and Claude Debussy. To begin the programme, my brother and I will start with Janacek's Pohádka, a three-movement sonatina for cello and piano, whose title translates to fairy tale. Janacek began composing this work in 1910, loosely based on Vasily Zhukovsky's epic poem, A Tale of Tsar Berende. Although Janacek states that this tale was the inspiration for the composition, it's not completely clear how exactly the score relates to the narrative. This work is more often thought of as a musical montage of scenes from the tale rather than a strict narration. Nevertheless, Janacek's aptitude for dramatic writing is enough to gain a sense of how the music might perhaps reflect the narrative. We open in the dreamy setting of a lake where the young Prince Ivan, represented by the cello's dotted pizzicato motif, meets and falls in love with Maria, represented by the piano. However, all isn't well for long as Maria's father, Kashkai, the king of the underworld, appears to hunt down Ivan. The two run away on horseback and the movement ends with the pounding of the horse hooves as they disappear into the distance. The second movement opens in a forest clearing as Ivan and Maria stumble upon the palace of a neighbouring Tsar and Tsarina and seek refuge. However, the Tsar and Tsarina wish for Ivan to be the groom to their own daughter, so the Tsar places a spell on Ivan, causing him to fall in love with the daughter. A musical outpouring of emotion follows as a heartbroken Maria's motif in the cello soars above rapid arpeggiated piano chords. The third movement arrives and the spell on Ivan has been lifted by a magician. Ivan and Maria then reach the sanctuary of Ivan's parents' palace, where they tell of their love and their adventures, celebrate and live happily ever after. Next to be performed is Janacek's Piano Sonata 1.x.1905, which represents the date, the 1st of October 1905. This composition was a response to the murder of 20-year-old Moravian carpenter František Pavlík, who, on the 1st of October 1905, was bayoneted at the hands of the military whilst protesting for the founding of a second Czech uni in the majority German town of Brno. Janacek immediately took to composing this tribute just a day after the incident and finished writing the three-movement sonata in early January of 1906. On the 27th of January of the same year, the day of the premiere, whilst Ludmila Tichkova was playing through the work to Janacek, the self-critical composer tore out the last movement from the manuscript and, in a fit of rage, threw it into a fire. Following the premiere, Janáček was still not satisfied with the first two movements either, and tossed the remaining manuscript score into the river Vltava. It wasn't until 1924 that Touchcover admitted to secretly copying down the first two movements after Janáček destroyed the third. The first movement, titled The Presentiment, opens with a plaintive right-hand melody interrupted by sudden angular interjections. The two motifs argue back and forth until they resolve into a manic trill, leading to a brief moment of peace. The next section grows more and more erratic, culminating in the eruptive statement of the once plaintive opening theme. The second movement, titled Death, is built solely around one five-note motif that persists all throughout the piece. Starting off in an almost prayer-like character, the theme's intensity builds during the development, with dotted rhythm interjections appearing in the left hand that override the whole texture in a violent, frenzied manner. The piece ends in total bleakness with the tolling of a funeral bell. Following the Janáček Sonata is a short work by the living British composer Cheryl Frances Hoad. Her work, titled In the Dew, is a tongue-in-cheek reference to Janáček's set of miniatures for solo piano named In the Mists. This work is commissioned from a set of miniatures called Homages, each work a dedication to a specific work by a composer. In Cheryl's own words, In the Dew was inspired by the third of Janáček's In the Mists, as well as his piano sonata. Much of the harmonic material comes from the former, and some of the melodic motives from the latter. The piece was written to be performed after the sonata as something of a palate cleanser after the sombre ending of Janáček's work. The next half of our programme focuses on the music of Debussy, with the two works being from opposite ends of his compositional timeline. The first to be performed is his set of images from 1894. This set of three miniatures is often forgotten in the canon of Debussy's work, often overshadowed by the much more famous images from books 1 and 2. The 1894 set remained unpublished for many decades, whilst the much more famous set of images were much widely more known, which led to the nickname of the set, Images Oubliées, or Forgotten Images. Unlike the latter two movements, the first movement doesn't come with a titled commentary about the piece. It opens with a simple unaccompanied melody in the right hand, outlining the F-sharp minor key, followed by an elegant harp-like arpeggio in D-sharp minor. Interestingly, the opening of this piece closely resembles the opening of his Prélude à l'après-midi d'enfant, written earlier in the same year, which starts off with similar textures of a solo flute followed by harps. The second movement's title commentary translates to in saraband tempo, that is to say with a grave and slow elegance, even a bit like an old portrait, souvenir of the Louvre, etc. In 1901, Debussy would go on to incorporate this movement in a slightly revised form as a central movement of his suite Pour le Piano. The third movement, titled Some Aspects of the Nursery Song Will Go to the Woods No More Because the Weather is Unbearable, uses a well-known French nursery song, Will Go to the Woods No More, a tune Debussy would later use in his Jardin sous la pluie. To end my programme, my brother and I will finish with Debussy's Cello Sonata. Written in 1915 amidst World War I, Debussy began a grand plan for six sonatas of various instruments, with the sixth sonata featuring all of the instruments from the previous five sonatas. At this point in time, Debussy knew he didn't have much time left. In 1905, he was diagnosed with cancer and underwent a grueling operation in 1915 that left him severely weakened and barely able to compose. Debussy died later in 1918 with only three of the six sonatas completed. The first for cello piano, second for flute, viola and harp, and the third for violin and piano. The prologue opens with a bold piano chord solidly in the key of D minor. However, conventional harmony disappears almost immediately to expose a more mysterious impressionistic sound. The development section drives further towards atonality until a resolute reprise of the opening measures appears in the key of C, with the cello triumphantly high in its range. The serenade starts with the cello plucking out a low, rhythmically unstable motif. This movement is filled with wandering tonalities and irregular rhythms created by short bursts of accented notes, interruptions, and sudden changes of tempo. After a static and suspenseful ending, the music launches straight into the finale, which is characterized by extreme shifts in tempos and sound worlds, going from seductive Spanish sounds to lively folk-like melodies to an indulgent Parisian style, without hesitation. Thank you for listening to my introduction of our program. I hope you enjoy the performance, and do tune in for the Blyth Centre's other lunchtime concerts.
Thank you. Thank you.
you.